So this will be a bit of a Miss Universe pageant. Like, they will try to answer each question very quickly. 1 to 2 minutes is what we agreed each answer to be. Clear? What is the essence of a woman, of being a woman, of course, respective of your particular experience and context? You can start.
Okay. What is the essence of a woman? For me, it's myself. It's my inner decision, inner thinking, inner reflection of who I am. I am a lesbian. So this one is female. This one is female, but I am attracted to another female. The gender expression can be both. It's feminine and masculine, because now it's Tuesday, so I'm masculine. Masculine. So tomorrow, I'm feminine. So MWF, it depends. And on Sunday, depends. My partner and I will do a toss coin, who will be the male or female. But that's how fluid my gender expression can be. And what is my essence? I'm also a lesbian parent. My partner has an adopted daughter, and I am, by law, a friend, because there's no legal right for two women to adopt a child. As a single gay and a single lesbian, you can do. But too much essence of a woman for me.
Thank you so much. Next, Professor Bernadette.
Thank you for that wonderful question. The essence of being a person for me is the ability, you know, to be self-aware and at the same time be aware of the multifaceted, multi-layered concept of identity, which is not centered only on gender, on sex, but also in our ethnicity, in our socioeconomic status, our sectors, the sectors where we belong, our nationality. And so by being aware, the essence doesn't stop that, but also in the understanding the solutions to the struggle that these layers are being confronted that we are being confronted by. So, and more than that, so being aware, understanding the complexity of the problem, and forming a complex solution also, and also actively engaging in the collective effort to promote human rights and, of course, social peace based on social justice. So that is the essence of being a woman.
Thank you, Professor Bernadette. Another piece of homework for you, intersectionality. Look that up. That touches on something that she said. Next, Attorney Jazz.
Yes, hi. So we have a timer here, so wow. We have to hurry up. So I'm Jazz. I'm a lesbian lawyer. I know that most people, after a while, they forget my name. They just call me that, no? A lesbian lawyer. And nothing else. Essentially, I believe that as essence of a woman definitely must have in its very grain is the idea of diversity. I think that all different kinds of stories are valid stories. There's no single story that's right out there. And just by respecting the difference, finding some common ground in those differences is what makes of the modern woman, I think. And aside from that, probably realizing that there is no taking whatsoever when you recognize the difference of one another. If you recognize the womanhood of a trans woman, it doesn't make you any less of a woman. It doesn't make you any less of a man. And in fact, it makes you more humane, more human. So I think people feel that if you recognize a difference, it means that you're taking away something. And I've never believed that. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Very good answer, Attorney Jess. Nikki?
Thank you. Hi, good afternoon, everybody. For me, this was a difficult question because my answer is that there is no essence of a woman. yes.
We know.
Yes. right. So because that question in itself limits women. It erases so many of our multi-layered identities. All of us have our own individual experiences. And when we say that there needs to be an essence of a woman, then we let other identities and other experiences fall through the cracks. This is what we call erasure. So, for example, when you ask about the essence of a woman and you say that it's their femininity or their bearing a child and being a mother, you then raise the question of, are masculine-presenting women women? Or are in the queer community, the LGBTQ community itself, there's also that question of, are feminine presenting women LGBTQ because they look heterosexual? So, may kodigo ko. And this in itself, when we erase the experiences of all women, all the different layers and experiences of women, they fall through the cracks, and often this leads to violence because their needs are not responded and they're not recognized as women. So, thank you.
Thank you, Nikki. Megan?
I'm Megan Evangelista, I'm 19
You can
years
clap.
Old.
Yeah, if you really like the answer, you can...
You can clap.
Go ahead. Megan.
Or you can throw a firecracker at us. Anyway, I'm Megan again. I'm from Babaylan, it's corporate. I'm 90 years old and I represent Quezon City. We must be sympathetic to Sushmita Sen and the other two Miss Universe finalists in 1994 because they were asked a very unfair question about what the essence of woman should be, because I believe in what Nikki said, that there's no essence of being a woman. We must understand that the essence question leads us to a direction where we intentionally or unintentionally include and exclude certain individuals and fail to recognize their differences and other idiosyncrasies. The essence question also creates standards for women, and we may fall into the trap that older societies before us fell into, like creating standards for women and understand them through their body parts only. But the practical answer, I guess, if I could answer the question, is that it's a common factor what makes us women, and that is our identity. So if there's a practical answer to a very unfair question, it should be our common factor, which is we all identify as women. So there. Thank you, and I love you all.
Thank you. And finally, Naomi.
Yeah. Actually, my answer to that question has something to do with my response to how you introduced yourself. Because earlier you said that you were sure that you were born straight, that you were born a man. But this morning, Mian from PCW was quoting Simone de Beauvoir, and I would like to quote her as well, because, you know, we're with French people. And my answer to this question has something to do with something that Simone de Beauvoir wrote, The Second Sex, which was published in 1949. She said that one is not born a woman, one becomes one. And so for me, the essence of my womanhood as a trans woman, as a proud and out trans woman, is my self-determination. Simply put, it's my self-determined identity against all odds. Because when a trans woman identifies as a woman, her identity is under assault. It is under assault in the larger Philippine society, where because of the Filipino language, which is the word bakla, keeps insisting that she is not a woman, but she is this indigenous term, bakla, which is not her. It's also under assault in the LGBT community, where a lot of trans women experience the most extreme form of transphobia. I've had a chance to be part of an activity organized by gay men for HIV and AIDS, and it was a photo shoot, and they were asking us to line up by gender, and the gay man at the door insisted that I lined up with a man. And this is a gay man who was advocating for the human rights of people living with HIV and AIDS. It's also under assault among feminists, because there is a strain in feminism called trans-exclusionary radical feminism that denies the reality of a trans woman's gender identity. So, and even in trans communities in the Philippines, there's a certain kind of womanhood that one must aspire to if you are trans, that you must have surgery, that you must have fair skin, that you must play to the patriarchal ideals of beauty to be an acceptable trans woman. And this is usually the experience of a lot of trans women in the Philippines, that you need to be a good trans girl and not rock the boat and play the part of a dutiful woman. So for me, the essence of a woman that I ran out of time is my self-determined gender identity. Thank you.
You ended, Naomi, with some very good points, you know, the challenges that the patriarchy places on especially trans women. So let's use that to segue into our next question. What are the great challenges that you face in particular, in your particular context, as a woman of diverse Soji? You can start with that.
Well, there are many issues that transgender women in the Philippines face, but I'll only focus on one because it is something that we have to live with in our daily lives, and that is violence. The violence that we experience as transgender women starts with people denying who we are. To deny a trans woman her identity is a form of violence. To say that I am not a woman is a form of violence. But of course, this kind of violence also takes other forms. It can be physical, it can be verbal, it can be psychological. And a lot of trans women, when they experience physical brutality, it's always very extreme. And this is actually demonstrated by a very high profile case that I'm sure all of you are aware of, the murder of Jennifer Laude, who was a trans woman in Ilongapo, who was killed by an American serviceman. So if you look at the circumstances of how Jennifer was killed, she experienced extreme brutality. And when people found out that she was trans, then her gender identity was also denied. And when people started to investigate the case, the tendency of most people who were looking from the outside in were blaming her for what happened to her. They were blaming Jennifer Laude for the kind of violence, for the brutal violence that was inflicted on her. So this is something that trans women need to challenge, need to work with, and need to deal with as women in Philippine society.
Yes, hate crimes such as these are still a problem, unfortunately. And more knowledge is a first step in addressing the, go ahead, Megan.
Yeah, of course, the usual horror stories that many transgender women face in the workplace and also in schools, and I cannot stress more on that. And Naomi has already provided us a very broad and very extreme case, especially on what happened with Jennifer Laude. But I also want to mention that misogyny right now, especially in this conjuncture, is a great challenge that every woman faces, especially the danger of misogyny being placed in a position of power and being placed in Malacanang, for example. That's one of the greatest challenges that we face today. We cannot let Rodrigo Duterte get away with his misogyny as feminists that we are here today. And we also cannot allow women who pretend to be for women and enable misogynists in positions of power. Hello, Pia Cayetano. And hello, other women's groups who are in alliance with this particular president. If you're a woman and you enable a misogynist like Rodrigo Duterte, then girl, you cannot sit with us. And also a horde of trolls supporting and enabling and encouraging women who support misogynists in power, they feed each other. I think right now in this current political conjuncture, this is the greatest challenge that women face today.
Thank you, Megan. Yeah, the room is getting hotter. Is it just me? I think the room is getting a bit hotter, Nikki.
I'm not going to be as controversial as Ate Megan. Okay. The challenge is that in Metro Manila Pride, so what we do is we stage the annual Metro Manila Pride March, but part of that also is creating safe spaces for LGBTQ people in Metro Manila. And most of the folks that we reach in our organization are young people. These are folks who are still in college mostly, and some who are young professionals, and they're also people as young as 12 to 15 years old who reach out to us saying that they don't know what to do with their sexuality, they're not out at home. And these are actually the, when we had a survey, we ran a survey recently, and two of the biggest challenges that our community faces, the first is the lack of acceptance in the home. Time and time again, when there are where there's research about violence against LGBTQ people, the violence and the discrimination starts and is most vibrant and in the home. And we hear that everywhere, from young people to old people. They carry it with them until they grow old. And the second thing that that our community feels is lacking, or the challenges that they see is lacking, is the lack of protections in school as well and in the workplace. So, as LGBTQ women, these problems in itself are compounded because we experience them as LGBTQ people and then as women. So there are other layers of, or other intersections of oppression that we have to face. Right, so that's it.
Thank you, Nikki. Yes, Attorney Jess.
Okay, so I wouldn't also be as controversial with all the statements. Well, my seatmate has a very controversial hair. Basically, I think the problem, one, is stereotypes. Among people right now, even in workplaces, there seems to be an idea of what kind of work we are supposed to do. Most people probably look at me and expect that somehow I should be driving a tricycle because lesbians drive tricycles. It's a very good job, but I hope that you don't, if you want to find us, that we're not all in the toda. And I think some people also think that as a lesbian lawyer, I should know all lesbian lawyers because somehow we meet every month, no? Like a fraternity. But that's not it. And these are some of the stereotypes that are happening. And I think we have to shatter that, including stereotypes in the workplaces where if you are LGBT partners and couples, then probably you don't need to be promoted, because you don't have a family anyway, right? So maybe we should just give it to the senior members, the one with 10 children, because they need it more. You don't have any. So these are the things that are happening. Number two is data. We have tried our best to try and find data, but most of them are anecdotal because we don't have the funds to have the scientific ones, the traditional ones. And it's very difficult to use traditional methods of data gathering because you can't exactly knock on a door and ask how many gay people are in your home. You cannot do that. It's a non-traditional way of data gathering. And number three is our absence in the law, the protections in the law. When we're present in the law, it's always to prohibit. For example, legal separation. We're a ground. Homosexuality is a ground in legal separation. I am an alcoholic, I think. And also, alcoholism is part of the ground. So if I get married, I already have two grounds. But then we don't need that, right? So what we need are protections. And up to now, our ADB is languishing in Congress, our anti-discrimination bill. Sooner or later, it will be 18 years old. It will have its own debut. But it's not being passed yet. So I think those are the three problems. I'm sorry if I exceeded my time. I'm going to get some demerits, no? Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Professor Bernadette.
Okay. I would like to speak as part of the academe, a woman part of the academe, and also a tibo, the colloquial term for lesbian. Nakaka-bother yung oras ni Ate Ging. Anyway, the challenges that we face in the academe is actually involves the concept of internationalization. So, for example, in UP, the increasing rates of the tuition fee and that causes a lot of intelligent intelligent youth, to not be able to access a tertiary education because of the lack of support, no, to the education as a social service, no, by the government, not just this government but the other all of the previous regimes. So aside from that, no, how does it affect us, no, the teachers, no? So it affects us that I teach Panitika ng Pilipinas, Labing Siyam. It tackles sex, gender, and literature. So we go back to history, and it is part of the. It's like a whole SEM of gender sensitivity training, but grounded on Philippine literature. But because of the internationalization that caused the academic calendar shift and the reform on the general education program, these subjects that espouses the that promotes gender sensitivity in various fields like SOGI and media, LGBT and psychology will be dissolved because of this neoliberal policies. No, sorry for the big words, but I just have to say these words because these are the challenges that I face. And also, for my personal experience, aside from being discriminated as a woman in the workplace, I also experience gender-based violence, particular to sexual harassment from my colleagues, from students, that's it. Time's
Thank you.
Up.
And lastly, Ging.
Okay, so why do I always stand up? Basically, LGBTI people, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, intersex people, are considered second-class citizen or maybe third-class. We are tolerated, not accepted. Tolerated is more of, we have to endure you, there's something wrong with you, but we'll just, up to this point, it's like this statement, okay lang, tomboy ka, basta. It's okay that you're lesbian as long as you're not the partner of my daughter. It's okay that you're gay as long as you're not working in a company. It's okay that you're a transgender woman, but don't use our female toilet. It's okay that you're human, but don't ask for your rights. So, name it, school, family, companies, establishments, even just to party. For a transgender woman to wear female clothing, they're not allowed to enter. For schools, you're not allowed to graduate because you have to wear a dress. I wore a dress with rubber shoes, so just so that I can graduate in high school. Our family, I'm not even asking for legal protection for our rainbow family or families with children of lesbian couples or gay couples or a transgender woman and her male partner. We don't have rights. So if my daughter example. If my partner passed away, my daughter goes to her family. If she gets sick, I don't have any right to bring her to the hospital or to give permission to the doctor to admit her, to tell her that you can be operated on. And if she dies, even her family can say, stay away, 200 meters away. All our things, it's going to be divided into half. So half for her family, half for me. I'm not even about discussing about legal rights. So that is our challenge every day. And then my daughter also, because she has two beautiful, sexy moms.
Thank you, Ging.